I'll introduce you to Mika.
Perfect.
She's coming out. Mika's helps us out at Debs Park as part of the team as well. It's Lauren.
Hi, Lauren.
Hi, Mika. How are you?
I'm good. How are you doing?
I'm good. We're on Instagram Live, and we wanted to hear stories about Debs Park, about Northeast LA, about celebrating Marco, celebrating your involvement with Debs. Do you have any stories that just popped to mind about any of that?
I guess not off the top of my head. I would just say that, you know, I'm super grateful to be able to work at the center, and I live in Cypress Park as well. So it's been an awesome experience to be able to really, you know, serve the community where we work and where we live as well, and to be able to you know, do this work under Marcos's guidance as well. I feel lucky to have this opportunity, and I've definitely learned a lot. And I appreciate, you all and the support of our work at Debs Park as well. And I see you're at Occidental College. I actually graduated from there as well.
Oh, no
awesome.
Way. Okay. What did you study here?
I did sociology.
Okay.
Yeah.
And did you have to write a thesis?
I did. I wrote it on how people's different, like the environments that they grow up in impact, you know, kind of who they are and how they turn out to be. So, yeah, I really enjoyed my experience at Oxy.
Cool. That's so interesting, because when I think about Marcos and think about his, like, being from Northeast LA and, like, educated here and now, you know, understanding forestry and management and environmental design, and kind of how the place he's lived has kind of continued to be a palette for his imagination. Like, it doesn't stay the same thing. The same place can become many different things throughout time.
There it is.
Definitely. Yeah. 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 It's been really cool. I feel like working at the center has been able to provide me with a really, like, a lot more rooted sense of space with both, like, the physical community and the community of people, as well as, you know, the birds and the plants and all of that, and just being able to feel, yeah, a lot more connected to the land here, and be able to protect that land as well, is extremely rewarding. And yeah.
So when you were a kid, did you used to spend time in Debs Park?
No, so I actually grew up in Seattle, and then I came down here when I went to Occidental, and then I stuck around in the area since then.
Right. So you're from the Greater West, but not from the marriage part.
Yes, exactly.
That must have been a strange adjustment to, like, adjust your eye from like the forests of the Cascade Mountains to the, you know, Arroyo Seco and the hills around it.
Exactly. It's definitely a big adjustment, but I like it here. I like it here too.
Hey,
I'm stepping off.
Hey,
nice
Lauren.
To talk to you.
You too.
This is Heidi. Heidi helped us out with the anti-displacement toolkit. She was at public council.
Hi, Heidi.
She's now at the county.
Thank you.
So she definitely.
Yeah. I heard you do some work on the LA River.
Yeah, I've been working on a piece of infrastructure readaptation to take a small part of the low flow channel of the river, lift it using its own momentum, put it to a wetland, and distribute it to the floodplain again.
So I used to be on the steering committee and the lower LA River revitalization, like, work group, and I think I reviewed that project, but it seemed like a really awesome, now I work for the county now, so I'm no longer on the committees, but it seems like a really promising revitalization project that's going to be really important in the future of, like, rebuilding this river. So good work, and thank you so much
for this. Thank you. What are you up to in the county now?
I'm an attorney. I'm county counsel for Los Angeles County Department of Public Works.
Wow, that's a big job.
So I love it, but I definitely miss public counsel, and I miss the community-oriented work. So,
right. So maybe we need to bring more community into the public works sector of the county.
I think that public works, especially now, is making a really strong push for that, and I know that right now the focus is on, like, the transportation impacts. They have new guidelines that are refocusing, like, how we analyze transportation and traffic to make it more community centered and not so much about, like, how much traffic does this project, you know, generate, and more about, like, how much, like, community serving, retail community serving services does this project provide. And so there was a huge push, but then the pandemic started and it's really hard to have too much public participation right now. So everything's on hold. And but I'm sure that it'll start back up in a few months, hopefully.
Yeah. Well, I think it's such an important area, you know, because the studio had to get a private water right in order to distribute a small portion of the low flow channel through our water right, we in a way have to rethink what's the community, what is a community utility look like what is this water serving, how. So a lot of this kind of conversation about how to bridge public works utility with citizenship is a kind of interesting thing. It's completely outside of the political narrative.
Well, right now, I think the most important thing for people to do is get involved with the LA River EIR process. The CEQA environmental impact report that's currently undergoing public review, like getting involved in that process, it's such a powerful place to, like, you know, have community input, and there's accountability that's built into CEQA. So I think.
Hey, Lauren.
Okay. Hi.
This is Michael Martinez from LA Compost. He's one of our partners.
Bridge at the studio.
I know. Thank you so much. That has helped us so much. You cannot believe it. But boy, did it make us realize how much more composting we need.
No,
in
yeah,
order
I'm
to make
talking
enough.
With Nancy Clam, and we're putting together a good plan to get it going again during this time.
Oh, good. Yeah. Nance has been talking to us too, so that's good that we're talking to her all
the
time.
Yeah, Millie put us in touch. But no, this is great, and you know, obviously, we're here to support Marcos and the good work he's doing in Northeast LA and everywhere and surrounding areas. So yeah, just happy to be here. Thank you for putting it together, and yeah, just here to give our support.
Yeah. Yeah, well, besides ice cream, making soil is about my favorite thing to do.
Yeah, it's a close second place for sure.
Will you talk to people a little bit out there on Instagram Live about what LA Compost does?
Absolutely, yeah. So LA Compost, about 7-year-old nonprofit here, all throughout LA County, and our goal really is to restore lost connections to both the soil and one another, and we do that through the sacred act of compost, and obviously it's nothing new. We're taking the practice of what people have done before and really implementing it all throughout the city, schools, churches, community gardens, housing projects, anywhere where there's food, where there's people, and the ability to really close the loop and tell the full story of food. We kind of create some programming around that, and we work as a decentralized model. We hire our staff from the communities where we're at, and to date we have 33 locations around LA County composting over close to 2 million pounds of organics a year, all by hand. So it's a great time to be composting. Obviously, the silver lining of COVID is more people are cooking, more people are gardening, more people are asking the questions as to where their food is coming from, where is it going. So really excited to be a part of this network of growers like Metabolic, Farm Lab, Autobahn, and everywhere else. So yeah, thank you for letting me share that really quick.
Oh, of course. Thank you so much. You know, in this period of COVID, Metabolic has really kind of reinforced the idea that it would be a good idea to learn how to support each other and our community with food and medicine.
Absolutely.
You know, because we take a whole lot for granted until there's a real crisis. And then you realize how important it is to be able to have access to food and medicine.
Absolutely.
And the single thing that everybody said after this first season of growing more consciously was how critical it was to have access to soil and how difficult it is. So it really made me realize there's not that many places in the city where you're allowed to compost. There's issues around composting, like, you know, knowledge of how to do it in a relatively disease-free way. So there's a lot to teach and a lot to learn. And I thank you so much for being our helpers and teachers this year. We got a lot when we upgraded to LA compost style.
No, but to that point, yeah, we're excited. LA just passed a healthy soils motion to allow for soil building and the elimination of spreading of glyphosates and stuff on parkland. So we're really getting the city to keep an eye on it, but actually prioritize it. So I agree with you that access to healthy, clean soil is a right for all of us, right? And it should be normal and everywhere you look. So I agree.
I wanted to ask you a kind of techie soil question. I was thinking about biochar in relationship to the forest fires that have just happened in the Los Angeles mountains. And so I was talking to the people in the county who manage the reservoir in the Los Angeles forest, because when the rainy season comes, a lot of that burnt wood and burnt material will go into one of two reservoirs up there. And I guess my question is, I know that biochar is an activator for compost, and I'm wondering whether you feel that something like a biochar could be useful for your processes in making more, going faster, or whatever.
Absolutely. The thing with biochar and just fires in general is, like, we've tried it and we've gotten the fire department called on us every single time. There's just this fear of it, but like you mentioned, fire is very normal and actually required and needed in nature. But yeah, biochar at, like, the biological level is like penne pasta. So it's very much a storage unit, little sheds and garages that holds a lot of the good nutrients that compost and healthy soil has. So biochar by itself is great, but biochar actively mixed with compost or vermicompost is just takes it to a whole nother level, because it provides that structure, stability, and allows for all those nutrients to be stored and held together. So I think it's something we definitely want to explore. Another thing to consider is, like, brush fire clearance happens every year for every vacant lot or park across LA. All that brush could be used for mulch, could be used for biochar, could be used for something else than just daily covering at a landfill. So I think it's just a matter of reimagining how we look at things and understanding that everything has value and is a resource and is just waiting to be reallocated in the neighborhood.
And I think also because we need to reimagine the labor force, because there's so many agencies that you would need to work through to bring twigs from the forest to LA compost, for example.
Right.
You need
right.
like county permits, city permits, all right. you know, truck permits, all the right. rest of it. So
one thing we are doing is Angel City Lumber, which is not too far from Metabolic.
Yeah, I've been there. They're amazing.
Yeah, they produce 20 yards of sawdust and shavings a month. Starting next week, we're going to be picking it up every week to be reallocating it to our parks and hubs. And yeah, it's to your point. How do we reimagine how we move this material? So it's a job that is created, is a job that is worthy of having, and is a job that someone is proud to do, you know, so.
And it reminds me about, like, reimagining dirt, making dirt soil again. It's like when you advocate for soil, a lot of times you have to work through people's idea that it's dirty.
Yeah.
Right? And yet, if we could, like, really understand how valuable it was, we might reevaluate it and shape labor around it.
I think it's as simple as recognizing that soil is alive, because anything that is alive deserves protection, and we are aware that it deserves protection. If there was a bird, obviously in light of Audubon, that was hurt, we'd ensure that it was cared for and healthy and rehabilitated. And for our soil, I think we got to recognize that it too is alive, and it too deserves our protection. It too deserves covering and respect. And the need to be able to regenerate life. So I agree. It's a simple change in thinking and approach, but a lot of people are hungry and excited to continue to move forward in that direction.
Yeah. Well, I'm so glad you're doing what you're doing. And how's it working for you with Debs Park? Is it education?
It's phenomenal. Marcos has been a partner of ours for the past 4 years. And to date, we're composting easily 2,000 pounds of food scraps every week at his site, getting all the arborists that would otherwise dump their mulch at the landfill to drop off at his park. And pre-COVID, we were having a solid amount of volunteers churning the piles. We had some big worm bins. And yeah, his model that allowed us to pilot there has really allowed us to now grow into potentially Griffith Park and some other parks around the county. So Marcos, his team, the Audubon Center have just been huge partners of ours, and we really can't thank them enough. Every site that we have is in partnership with a solid community organization like the Audubon Center, because they've done the legwork to build the level of trust and transparency with the community. And we just get to, like compost, add a little bit of value in life to the goodness that they're already doing. So yeah, it's super, super honored to work alongside him and really privileged to be able to do this work as well.
Oh, thank you for saying those things so that the public can celebrate him. with the banana split. Like, that really helps to explain Marcos Trinidad.
I don't think you know, like, this line. Like, it's just, like, getting crazy. Like, it's, and this park is huge. So, yeah, it's good. It's a good form of messaging. So, it's great chatting with you, Lauren. And
awesome. Thank you.
And have a great weekend, right? Take care.
Thank you. You too. Thanks for hanging.
Of course.